Hi everyone, hope you're all doing well. In this video, I wanted to switch it up a bit and just offer some advice on things that I've seen in my career, specifically as it relates to SQL queries. I've worked in the past on a SQL Server, PostgreSQL, MySQL, most recently on Snowflake and some of the cloud providers, but I think a lot of these concepts apply, and hopefully I can share some of my experiences to help, you know, maybe you solve a problem or approach something a slightly different way. So number one, start with a filtered data set. I can't tell you how many times a query has been performing really slow. The user complains, you know, it takes forever to load. And the first thing I notice when hopping into the procedure or the query is that everything is being done at the same time. There's no separation of data and you're looking at full tables. There's no filtering whatsoever, which means that every single join that's happening, every case statement, every transformation is happening on every record in every table. And a lot of times, even if it's not everything, it's too much. And every extra record, especially on these row-based databases like SQL Server, for example, that can really blow up your query time. So the first thing I always suggest and that I always do is to start with a filtered set at the very top. You have to understand what is the actual granularity that you're concerned with. If you're writing a query to return something on a customer level, you need to figure out the first thing, what are the customers you actually care about? Are you only looking at something in a specific time frame? Are you only looking at certain customers in a region for this query? Isolate just those customers in that example or whatever it is at the top, whether it's in a temp table or something, and just start from there. And then everything down as your query goes on, you reference that set. But that way you're only working with what you really need and what you care about. You're not processing anything on data you don't care about. If in a particular query you only care about customers, you know, in the West region, why would you spend any processing power or any query time running it against ones from the East or the South that you don't care about? So something to think about. That's usually the number one thing I look for when looking to performance tune any query. Number two kind of falls in line with the first one I mentioned. Use temp tables and CTEs, which if you're not familiar, stands with common table expressions. At a high level, I think using either of these allows you to organize your query in a much better way. Similar to the first point, you isolate just the data that you care about. You could put that in a temp table and then you reference that temp table in any future join. So then everything else is, you know, you're joining on that, you're not doing any extra work. Another benefit of isolating things into temp tables is that it gives you the ability to focus on maybe specific logic separate from everything else. For example, another culprit of really slow performing queries is oftentimes people are trying to do way too much in just one huge select statement. Those operations are going to happen on every single record. You can isolate that into a temp table. One thing I really like about temp tables as well is debugging. You know, if you have, you know, six temp tables, you can fill the first three, see where you're at. There's duplicates or there's an error. You can figure out where it's happening along your query. Again, as opposed to having it all together, it's really difficult to figure out where the problem is. Another thing to consider here when working with these temp tables is only return the columns that you need. You don't need to return everything. Anything else other than what the final select is actually going to need. You're just wasting resources and cluttering up your query with things that you don't actually need. If you need to debug it and see them, add it while you're debugging, but then remove it when you save it. Number three, don't repeat yourself. This is applicable to every programming language. You've probably heard it many times to the point where it's kind of annoying, but it's true. You know, if you're reading code and you see that you're doing the same thing more than once, that should be a sign that you probably can simplify this some way. Maybe you're doing the same join multiple times, or maybe you're converting a column type multiple times. You probably shouldn't need to do that. So keep an eye on that. If you find yourself doing things more than once, definitely hone in on that and figure out how you can simplify it. Number four, use indexes, especially on the row-based databases like SQL Server. Use indexes where you can. If you don't feel comfortable creating them yourself, understand what the indexes are on the tables you're working with. The primary keys, you know, clustered indexes, non-clustered indexes, which are more of like a reference point, foreign key relationships. Understanding these things will help the execution plan find what it needs to much quicker and ultimately improve your performance. I've seen some queries, you know, that were taken several minutes to run, jump down to a second or a couple of seconds just by adding indexes correctly. It's important that you understand how to do it, because you can add indexes and make the problem worse if you don't know what you're doing. Getting into the weeds and understanding how this works and using them effectively will really improve your query performance. The two big ones that you'll often see are clustered indexes and non-clustered indexes. I think the best way to understand the difference is through the example of a book. A book has two ways to reference information. You have the table of contents and you have an appendix. The table of contents lists things in sequential order. It says, you know, chapter one starts on page one, chapter two is on page 10, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they're all ordered by a certain criteria. In the case of a book, they're all ordered by a page. In the case of SQL world, you can think of the index as the ordering of the table. Most of the time, this is on an ID. And if you're saying the ID is the index, that's kind of like saying the book, AKA the table, is ordered by ID. So you start from the lowest to the highest or whatever the order is, and that's how the book is structured or the table is structured. So when a query comes through, it says, okay, I need to find ID number 10. It knows exactly where to look. I can find out very quickly where this record, where this row exists based on the ID, because I know the order of it. I know how it's structured. Number two, non-clustered indexes. Those are more like an appendix. You can create non-clustered indexes on multiple columns and different ways, but really it's more of a reference. It's not saying, you know, the book or the table is structured by this way, but you can find what you need by using it as a reference point. Let's say a book has the topic of sales. If you were someone who wanted to figure out where all the sales pages were, you would go to the appendix and you would see those pages, and then you would look in those and see if that's what you need. In a similar way, creating a non-clustered index creates those appendix-like reference points for your table. Let's say you have an orders table and you create a non-clustered index on customer. That is basically saying we're going to create a separate reference guide for the execution plan to go through. Anytime you see that join, it's going to know quickly, you know, where it should probably be looking and find it much faster. So those are the ways you can incorporate that. I encourage you to learn more about those if you're not comfortable with them. They can really, really improve your performance time. You know, in the example of using a temp table, I mentioned you can use indexes. If you just add a generic temp table to your query and it's sitting there and you insert records, technically it's an unstructured table of data. There's no organization, there's no referencing. So the joins may not be super fast depending on what you're doing. You may have a smaller result set because maybe you filtered that temp table down. And in terms of execution plan, there's nothing really helping it out. But adding indexes such as clustered or non-clustered on temp tables will help that as well. But, you know, test it around yourself. There's no one size fits all. Sometimes you add an index and it slows it down. Sometimes it helps significantly, you know, so just play around with it and hopefully that'll help you out. And number five, the last one, be consistent. And this is maybe just a pet peeve of mine, but I think it's really important to be organized and consistent in what you're creating, whether it's indentation, spacing, naming structure. There's obviously a ton of ways to do the same thing, to accomplish the same output, but whatever you decide, do it the same way throughout. Don't be adding three indentations on one place and one on the other, putting things on separate lines, one part of your query but not in the other. I just think it keeps it much cleaner, it's easier to read, and I think it's like night and day when you open up somebody's procedure that is very consistent and structured well, and someone's who is just all over the place. It's like walking into a room that's completely unorganized compared to somebody who's got all the things in the right places and tucked away and you know exactly where things are. So I think that's a very subtle detail that can really separate you in terms of how your work is viewed. And ultimately, just don't be lazy. I think that's what it comes down to. So that's it for this video. I know it's a little different, a lot of information. Hopefully you guys found some value out of this. I'm really curious to hear maybe some other things that you guys have found in your experience in addition to these things. And feel free to leave a comment and let's talk about it. I'll likely do some more of these if you find these helpful. Everybody's got their own opinions on, their own ways of doing things. But one way to get better is to just talk about it and bounce ideas off people. So if you found this helpful, give it a thumbs up. subscribe, comment. It'd be very much appreciated. Thanks for watching.